Hello, my name is Travis Williams, President and CEO of Academics and Athletic Consulting, focusing on educating and empowering tomorrow's collegiate athletic leaders. My passion is for the education and genuine concern and care for today's student athlete. It's the centerpiece of my life's work. A college education, both in and out of the classroom, is a truly rewarding benefit. For more information on AAC, you can go to www.academicsandathleticsconsulting.com. Once again, www.academicsandathleticsconsulting.com. Or you can follow me on Facebook at Academics and Athletic Consulting, or Twitter at Coach TWill24, or Instagram Travis L. Williams 24. Or you can call me at 404-542-607. Once again, AAC is very proud to partner with J.R. McHenry of the Bossman Radio Show, covering sports and entertainment across the country. Please tune in weekly for informative, entertaining, and expert analysis on today's sports and entertainment topics. Thank you.
For all your photo, video, and voiceover needs, check out the fine folks at Blu-ray Productions. They will take good care of you. If you don't believe me, you can see for yourself. Check out their work at blueberryproductions.tv, the Facebook page, Blueberry Productions, also a Vimeo page, a YouTube page, and it's Blueberry, B-L-U-B-E-R-R-Y, prod on Twitter. Check them out today. Blueberry Productions, great people, great work, great service.
Fantasy football season is fast approaching, and if you're looking for an edge this season, you need to contact the guys at Draft Day Consultants. The concept is a simple. Draft Day Consultants takes your requests and connects you with one of their trusted analysts, who then guide you through your draft, whether you just need a sounding board on decisions, or if you need them to conduct your entire draft. Draft Day Consultants has you covered. Every one of their consultants has a proven track record of success, and have conducted hundreds, even thousands of mock drafts. Thanks to this year-round research and analysis, the guys at DDC have an unmatched understanding of player values. So gain an edge on your league mates this season by hitting up DraftDayConsultants.com. That's www.DraftDayConsultants.com. Now get after it, fantasy footballers.
A gorgeous tan from Suntan City gives you an inner glow that relights the fire when you run into your first crush.
Vicky, who was that?
An old boyfriend.
Lucky you just tanned at Suntan City.
Lucky he's single. We're doing lunch tomorrow.
Won't be single for long then.
During Tour of the City, try all 5 tans, including spray tan, for just $4.99. Restrictions may apply. Click to buy now.
Hip hop fans, I got a great album for you. The debut album from Family Grind ENT, True Speech and 313 Fresh, bringing you 2 discs, 33 songs of pure, genuine hip hop. Albums available on iTunes, Amazon, Google Play, illstreetrex.com, and streaming live right now on Rhapsody, Beats Music, Spotify, Xbox Music, Slacker Radio, and SoundCloud. Check them out today. True Speech and 313 Fresh, Family Grind ENT. Believe in it. Get it.
Yeah, it's your man JC, the host with the most, baby, and it goes down each and every Saturday night right here in the city of Memphis. That's right, y'all. It goes down at Clicks Sports Bar Memphis, baby. 3705 Malco Way, Memphis, Tennessee, 38125. Come out and join us, the Three Kings, each and every Saturday night for the livest karaoke in the city. Everybody gets in free till 10 p.m. Only $5 after. Great food. We got drink specials. We got all kind of games, man. We got the pool tables popping. Whatever you want, we got you, man. Come on out. Have a good time with us each and every Saturday night. That's Clicks Sports Bar, Memphis.
Ken and Gerald, the Boss Man Show, and be joined by Dave Dickerson, new head coach of the UNC Upstate Spartans out there in Spartanburg, South Carolina. Sound like going to a lot. Coach Dickerson, man, how's it going out there, man, in Spartanburg?
It's going great. I really appreciate you guys having me on the show, and but it's been going good. This is my 75th day on the job, and I think we are getting better every day, and hopefully we can continue to get better and stay healthy.
And Coach, how important for you to feel like having these extra 4 hours, this 4 hour with the workout up from 2 hours now to kind of help see your guys on the court, going from through drill work, kind of see what they're about in certain situational things. If you want to get into it, you can do that. And it's kind of spend some time with the guys on the court to kind of get a feel for how you are as a coach.
You know, I think it's very important, and just to give you a little bit about our situation, we have only 5 guys returning on scholarship, and so we've had to go out and try and rebuild a team and rebuild a program, and we've signed 6 guys, and right now, presently, we're in our second session of summer school, and we only have 4 scholarship players and 1 walk-on. And so we're working with those 5 guys and using the 4 hours to be on the court with them. And then the last session of summer school that starts July 9th, we have our 6 incoming freshmen. So, but I think the 4 hours is very important because now you get a chance to build a rapport, like you spoke about early, from player to coach and coach to player. But you also get a chance to have a regular practice situation, and what we're doing is we're using 2 hours to run a regular practice and try and get as much in with 5 guys as you possibly can, and then we're using the other 2 hours for individual workouts to spread throughout the week. So it's been good for me from the aspect to see the players in a situation where you have them in a practice situation, but also to evaluate my coaches I have on the staff as well.
Yes, indeed. And now, Coach, just trying to integrate this roster coming in here in July. So, how much would it change from in July when you get those 6 other guys in there? You may probably be able to run some 5-on-5s and shell drills and kind of put out an even bigger practice plan that you probably use in October and November going forward when the season starts.
You know, that's a really good point, and that's what I'm looking forward to. Instead of having a 2-hour practice with 5 guys, now we have a chance to have it with 12 guys with 1 walk-on added into that situation. And then we'll be able to test their stamina and test their basketball IQ and their retention. And so those things will be important. But most importantly, the one thing that we got to emphasize in this program is how can we become a better defensive team? As you know, last year, Upstate basketball was the very last when it came to defensive efficiency in the NCAA. So, in other words, there are 351 teams. We were 351st in total defense. And so those practice opportunities give us a chance to install our man-to-man defense and our defensive principles and all those things that you need to do in order to be able to win championships.
I can envision Coach a lot of shell drills and a lot of one-on-one defending, two-on-one, two-on-two. I can imagine all the drills we do back when I played. I can only imagine what's coming their way to get them on defensively ready to play ball. Because like I say, if you don't defend, you can't win. That's what I was always told. If you don't defend, you can't win. You can score all day, but if the shots ain't going down, if you're not defending, you're just going to lose. But if you get hot, you may win, not defend, but you got to defend to win.
And that's a great point. And the thing that we have to do within this program is we have to be able to get to the next play. And, and that's easier said than done, is trying to get the guys into a mentality where I'm not going to ask them to play perfect, but what I want them to do is play hard, and I want them to get to the next play and be better than they were the previous play. And if we can do those things, then we have a chance to install our system. As of right now, we're trying to install the terminology. We're trying to install the basics part of defense, which is, you know, contest every shot, not let the ball middle, and try and get to a good closeout stance. All those things are important as far as building the fundamental part of your defense. And then when you get your whole team together in July, then we'll have a chance to talk about schemes and talk about man-to-man and some principles and all those things, to where it's going to be important. But most importantly, we got to develop that mantra of getting to the next play and not let the previous play decide what's going to happen in the next play.
Now, Coach, how much of your experience with the Utah Jazz this past year help you as a coach and give you some more ideas on scheme and style and thoughts on how to attack certain defenses and certain plays or certain coaching styles?
Well, obviously, being in the NBA was a blessing, and the Utah Jazz gave me a unique situation when I needed a unique situation. And obviously, being around those guys a few days in training camp, and then being around those guys doing summer league last year in Vegas was very, very important to how I think as a basketball coach now. And obviously, one of the things that I've learned is that playing through the pass is very important, and being unselfish is very important, and playing through space. And obviously, all of those things sound easy, but you have to have some unselfishness, and you have to have some discipline in order to do those things. And I learned a lot from the coaching staff as far as watching those guys practice and watching those guys prepared to practice, and how important the small things were in the NBA, because everybody can play in the NBA. I mean, and so now, when you're not as talented as the top four or five teams in the league, you got to be able to hang your hat on something. And it's playing through the pass, playing with space, and being able to defend.
Now, Coach, because I saw Coach Snyder here with the Hawks and under Coach Budenholzer, so I kind of got to see him firsthand, how he works, how he thinks, and his mindset about the game of basketball. And for those who may not know intimately as you do, talk about a little bit how Coach Snyder is growing as a coach, and his methodology and his approach to how he coached that young, exciting Utah Jazz team they had out there this year.
Well, I think Quinn is obviously one of the better coaches in the NBA, and he, the thing that I got from this, and I know he probably won't say this, but the thing I got from him is that he's coaching the Utah Jazz very similar, like you coach a college basketball team, as far as transition defense is a staple for those guys, getting back in transition and stopping the ball, protecting the rim, and trying to build a wall. Those are the things he talks about on a daily basis, and then being unselfish, in which, you know, they have great players. Donovan Mitchell is a great player. Rudy Gobert is a great player. But you still want to play through the pass and be unselfish and move the basketball and pass up a good shot for a great shot. And so all of those things that I've seen him preach is similar to what we preach in college basketball. And so if you can coach a team that way, you're able to lose a great player the Howard kid that left and went to Boston. And I just think what he and his staff are doing right now is really neat to watch. But most importantly, they have the type of GM and the type of administration that helped them do those things.
And now, Coach, for you, a non-conference scheduling at Upstate, I know it's probably some guarantee games involved. You have to play, do some two-for-ones, get guys to come out there and play you guys. So, well, how big is the challenge for you trying to make the schedule and make it for the roster you have, not get your guys just so killed in non-conference play where they don't have any confidence going to conference play? So, well, how do you balance that knowing that you got my place, make some guarantees and do some two-for-ones and maybe play in a Zim tournament or two? So, how do you feel like you approach it going forward here?
Well, I'm glad you brought it up, and the normal listener don't understand the aspect of this level in which, you know, playing guaranteed games and playing by games is a big part of our program because that subsidized our budget from a total aspect. And one of the things that is important for us is to make sure that we have to bring in a certain amount of money to play these guaranteed games, but also play games that where we will have some interest as far as location is concerned. Like, to give example, we're playing Georgia Tech, and we're coming down to Atlanta and playing those guys, and we're also playing NC State. Well, our fans and the people in our region who root for Upstate, they know who Georgia Tech and they know who NC State is. And also, we're playing at South Carolina. Well, South Carolina is going to be a big game for us because we are part of the University of South Carolina system. So all those games are important to us because of the money aspect of it, but it's more so important for us from our guys playing against some of the best players in college basketball and getting a chance to improve your team by playing those games.
Exactly. Well, I'm going to definitely mark it on my calendar, the Georgia Tech game. Well, hopefully I'm in town that day. I'm not on the road with the Hawks or Falcons. Hopefully it'll be the time I'm in town when you guys play them. And, you know, like I said, a lot of people don't really get that. I have to explain to my listeners, Coach, about mid-major. There's a lot of things going on that you don't really realize is going on because the hardest thing for you guys in the mid-major level is to schedule games, especially if you get good. It's really hard if you get good. And then the high majors don't want to even touch you. It's like, we're not playing you. You know, so I think outside of recruiting, your biggest hurdles in the mid-major level is trying to schedule games, especially when you get good.
Well, the biggest issue that we have in college basketball and is facing programs like ours, the mid-major on down, is transferring. The transfer situation in college basketball has really gotten out of hand, and I think with the rules that the NCAA is considering imposing, I think it's going to get worse. So transfer is one of the biggest issues in college basketball, and especially at our level. So when you get good, it's not only the big boys don't want to play you, but the big boys are going to take your players. So it's one of those things where it's a catch 22. It's one of those things where you want to be good and you want to have good players and you want to have guys that get better from year to year to year. With the rules that we have in college basketball, and that the rules that we're considering imposing college basketball, I think the transfer situation is going to be get out of control. Now, that's the biggest issue we have in college basketball right now is a transfer. And for us, keeping good players is always going to be an issue. And we have to figure out some kind of way that we can keep our good players that progress from their freshman year to the junior year to where we can keep them in the program for the senior year, then we can make one of those special runs the way that two or three teams did in the NCAA tournament this year.
And finally, I want to add for you, Coach, you know, I'm a big proponent of the NBA game and the rules. And you was in the NBA game this year as a scout. So are there some NBA that you may want to bring down to college basketball, maybe like the advancing the ball to himself in the game, maybe the six personal fouls, four quarters, shot clock? Is there anything about the rules of the NBA game that you love to bring down to the D1 basketball level?
Well, I think the one thing that we got to do is we got to speed our game up some. And playing with a 24-second shot clock is going to be very, very important as we go forward. And getting into a situation where we can get up and down the court and make our game more exciting for our fans, because we have to do kind of what the NBA's done, in which they've made their game exciting. And one of the things that I would love to see instituted in college basketball is that we have a situation where we have an extra foul to where we can play our good players up to get in foul trouble. We can play those guys longer in a game. And if we can move the three-point line back a little bit to where now we can have more space on the floor to where we can operate better and we can use that lane more as a facilitator of offense instead of it being clogged up all the time. So those are two or three of the things I would love to see change. Shot clock, the spacing of the game, and increasing the foul totals to six instead of five.
Well, I'll tell you what, Coach Dickerson, I wish more coaches would get on board with you and I in that regard to make the game a little bit better rather than stay with the status quo. I feel like the game could use a little sprucing up, and I think that, you know, I'm a basketball head and so are you, but for the casual fan, you know, if you kind of make it a little more exciting for them, they'll tune in more than just to March. They'll tune in all year long rather than just in March.
And that's important that we can do. The welfare of our game is very, very important. And there's a lot of scrutiny going on with college athletics as far as should guys get paid, should guys not get paid, should guys value the scholarship more than they do. All of those things that we have to do as coaches to safeguard the game, to make sure that we are trying to improve the game to where we can get our fans and keep our fans more engaged from the start of the season to the end of the year as well.
Well, Coach Dickerson, I'm definitely happy for you to get this job at Upstate. I look forward to seeing you. Hopefully, when you come to Atlanta and play Georgia Tech, hopefully I'll be in town then. But if not, hopefully I'll try to catch you when you get in town before I have to leave out, man. But I'll definitely look forward to having you on again in the fall here, right before things get tipped off, see where your team is as you're hitting October, November, Coach.
I'd love to do that, and I really appreciate you. And I look forward to seeing you when we head down to Atlanta to play Georgia Tech.
All right, Coach. Have a great day, man. Talk to you real soon, Coach Dickerson.
Okay. Take care of yourself now.
All right. That's Dave Dickerson on the Boss Man Show.
Hello, my name is Travis Williams, President and CEO of Academics and Athletic Consultant, focusing on educating and empowering tomorrow's collegiate athletic leaders. My passion is for the education and genuine concern and care for today's student-athlete. It's the centerpiece of my life's work. A college education, both in and out of the classroom, is a truly rewarding benefit. For more information on AAC, you can go to www.academicsandathleticsconsulting.com. Once again, www.academicsandathleticsconsulting.com. Or you can follow me on Facebook at Academics and Athletic Consulting or Twitter at Coach TWill24 or Instagram Travis L. Williams 24. Or you can call me at 404-542-6079. Once again, AAC is very proud to partner with J.R. McHenry of the Bossman Radio Show, covering sports and entertainment across the country. Please tune in weekly for informative, entertaining, and expert analysis on today's sports and entertainment topics. Thank you.
For all your photo, video, and voiceover needs, check out the fine folks at Blu-ray Productions. They will take good care of you. If you don't believe me, you can see for yourself. Check out their work at blueberryproductions.tv, the Facebook page, Blueberry Productions, also a Vimeo page, a YouTube page, and it's Blueberry, B-L-U-B-E-R-R-Y, prod on Twitter. Check them out today. Blueberry Productions, great people, great work, great service.
Fantasy football season is fast approaching, and if you're looking for an edge this season, you need to contact the guys at Draft Day Consultants. The concept is a simple one. Draft Day Consultants takes your requests and connects you with one of their trusted analysts, who then guide you through your draft. Whether you just need a sounding board on decisions, or if you need them to conduct your entire draft, Draft Day Consultants has you covered. Every one of their consultants has a proven track record of success, and have conducted hundreds, even thousands of mock drafts. Thanks to this year-round research and analysis, the guys at DDC have an unmatched understanding of player values. So gain an edge on your league mates this season by hitting up DraftDayConsultants.com. That's www.DraftDayConsultants.com. Now get after it, fantasy footballers.
A gorgeous tan from Suntan City gives you an inner glow that relights the fire when you run into your first crush.
Vicky, who is that?
An old boyfriend.
Lucky you just tanned at Suntan City.
Lucky he's single. We're doing lunch tomorrow.
Won't be single for long then.
During Tour of the City, try all 5 tans, including spray tan, for just $4.99. Restrictions may apply. Click to buy now.
Hip hop fans, I got a great album for you. Today be album from Family Grind ENC, True Speech and 313 Fresh. We're gonna give you 2 discs, 33 songs of pure genuine hip hop. Albums available on iTunes, Amazon, Google Play, IllStreetRex.com, and streaming live right now on Rhapsody, Beats Music, Spotify, Xbox Music, Slacker Radio, and SoundCloud. Check them out today. True Speech and 313 Fresh, Family Grind ENT. Believe in it. Get it.
Yeah, it's your man JC, the host with the most, baby, and it goes down each and every Saturday night right here in the city of Memphis. That's right, y'all. It goes down at Clicks Sports Bar Memphis, baby. 3705 Malco Way, Memphis, Tennessee, 38125. Come out and join us, the Three Kings, each and every Saturday night for the livest karaoke in the city. Everybody gets in free till 10 p.m., only $5 after. Great food. We got drink specials. We got all kind of games, man. We got the pool tables popping. Whatever you want, we got you, man. Come on out. Have a good time with us each and every Saturday night. That's Clicks Sports Bar, Memphis.
Back on the Boss Man Show. Time for your weekly health segment with our health and wellness expert, Dr. Vernette, here with us on the Boss Man Show, joining John and myself. Dr. V, what do you do? How's things down in the ATL?
It's good. I'm burning up, you know. That's good. Like a typical summer day.
It's good to be burning up.
How y'all doing? Y'all in Cleveland, right?
Yeah. Finals time.
Yes.
Finals time. Hopefully John's Cavs go down in flames. Praying for that.
Oh goodness.
Looks like that's what's on the horizon.
Yeah, I hope that happens, because they need to go down in flames ASAP so LeBron can leave and go elsewhere and do whatever he does. Go Warriors.
Oh goodness. Oh, I love that.
Yes indeed. Well, today you're gonna talk to us about, you know, self-care, the importance of self-care. So what do you have for us today? We'll chime in as you break down for us the importance of self-care.
Okay. Well, I want to just jump in really quick and keep it simple. And like I said, you are more than welcome to jump into the conversation, you know, if something resonates with you. But yes, you're right. We're talking about taking good care of yourself and what that even means. So I have just four bullet points that I kind of want to discuss with you all briefly, and then we can kind of go from there. So let's go ahead and jump in. I want to start with working towards your goals, right? So we talk about goal setting. When we talk about goal setting, you want to make sure that you're focusing on your strengths when you're creating goals. Let's start over. When you're creating goals, you want to have SMART goals, right? Which, if my memory serves me right, S is for specific, M is for measurable, A is for accountability, R is for, you know, R is reliable.
Reliable,
and T is time management. So, I remembered. So those are the type of goals. When you're talking about goal setting, you want to have SMART goals, right? Things that you can measure, keep yourself accountable. They have a specific time frame to it. They're actually reliable goals, and that they're very specific, right? So you can be able to track them appropriately and then maybe modify them if you want. But the first thing that you want to do is focus on your strengths. Then focus on solving problems. So you want to start with focusing on your strengths, right? Because it's a high note. then you want to think about, okay, what are the things that I need to work on, whether it's in my personal or professional life? Focus on the future, and that goes more towards the long-term goal. And then the last thing about setting the goals is, you know, focus on what you want your life or how you want your life to progress, right? So I know I'm staying a little bit general, but a couple things that would make a little bit more sense is when you're writing down your goals, right, you can start with short-term goals, so maybe like a week, up to 3 weeks. You can then go into intermediate goals, which are like 3 to 9 months, 3 to 6 months. And then the long-term goals typically are 9 months and beyond. What I like to do is sit still quietly and figure out what my bird's eye view is of what I want my personal goals and my professional goals to look like. And then I actually kind of go backwards. I go through the intermediate and then the short term. It just helps me to see exactly what I need to do and the steps that I need to take in order to accomplish my goals, whatever goals it is, right? So that would be the first thing. In addition to that, in order to track the goals, you can do it in multiple ways, but there's two main ways that I like to suggest to my people, which is have a journal. That's really awesome because then you can track what's going on and make some modifications. But typically, the most common way to track your goals is having vision boards. So everyone has a vision board party, or they want to do their vision board. Usually, if that's more on the female side than the male side. However,
yeah, no, I wouldn't do that at the V.
Well, yeah, I know you guys just have amazing memories. You're like, you know what? I'm just going to roll with it, and we'll just see kind of how it unfolds. And
that's how me and John do it.
That's how y'all do it. And, hey, and there's no judgment on that.
Yeah, if I miss the mark on one of my goals and it's not on paper, I can just easily shift my goal to where I want to be.
Oh, is that how that works? Oh, okay. That works. Well, typically, that's why I said, typically women do have vision board parties where, you know, you're cutting out different clippings of magazines or writing different things on a board, and you hang it up. Unfortunately, our society kind of forgets about the vision board, similar to New Year's resolution, maybe 3 months. So we're in March when things kind of just disappear. But that's one reason why I go to the journal first, is because you can always keep that with you, whether you're stashing it in your work bag or your purse or, you know, in your car or whatever, you can always track that. Moving on to the second tier, which is caring for yourself and what that looks like. So really some advice that I have just for basic self-care is live healthier, right? So eat healthy foods, get enough sleep, exercise regularly, avoid drugs and alcohol as much as you can, and manage your stress so that way, you know, you're better able to receive situations as they come, right? Another suggestion is practice good hygiene, right? So that way it's important for social, it's important for medical and psychological reasons, so that way it reduces risks of illnesses, especially preventable illnesses. Then also you feel better, right, when you're taking care of yourself with good hygiene, and then other people respond better as well. Build a tribe. So visit friends, family, be around positive people that are going to bring about support in your life, especially if there's transitions that we go through, whether it's job or family changes, relationship changes, personal changes. We're always going through some type of transition. So it's great to be able to have a tribe that supports you during those transitions. Another suggestion that I have is try something that you enjoy every day. And I was talking to a family member of mine last week during Memorial Week, and we were talking about running through the sprinklers as a kid or climbing the monkey bars. So even stuff like that where you remember having fun as a child, or even in your teen years or your younger years, try something that you enjoy doing, right? It reminds you of the beauty of just the simple things. And the last suggestion for basic self-care is find ways to relax, right? So meditation, yoga, getting a massage, taking a bath, walking in the park or climbing the mountain, and that has to do with exercise regularly. The third thing
Doctor, before you move on, do you mind if I interject?
Yeah, well, no, I don't mind. I was going to say yes, but no, I don't mind.
Well, the one thing I wanted to ask you about that particular segment before you move on was, do you feel that it's beneficial for people when you mentioned, you know, taking better care of yourself and doing small things in order to do that. So, for instance, if you wanted to lose a few pounds, or if you're trying to quit smoking, or if you're trying to quit drinking or cut down on your drinking or smoke, whatever the case may be, do you feel like it's beneficial for people to engage in those behaviors, like in small doses, to kind of work up to it? So instead of trying to all of a sudden cut out all chocolate from your life, you know, because you're on a diet, maybe the first week you cut back, you know, 10% or 20%. And the next week you kind of build on top of small successes, I guess, is what I'm getting at. Do you think it's beneficial for people to do that?
Absolutely. I mean, what I suggest, honestly, and what works is taking those baby steps. So that goes back to the goals, right? So if you're talking weight management and eating healthy, track it in your journal. Track what you're eating. Do an assessment first to see, okay, where am I at? Where am I lacking? So especially when we talk about eating healthier and wanting to transition into a healthier lifestyle, honestly, what I tell my clients and my patients is that track everything. Even if it does not look so great on paper, that holds you accountable. And so with the accountability, you're able to assess, okay, this is how much I'm taking in. Even when you talk about sugar drinks or even alcoholic drinks, I've got, you know, guys who drink beer with the guys, you know, and it's basketball season, so well, it's ending now. But still, I mean, I know that there's a higher consumption of alcohol right now because it's a social environment. Everybody's getting together for the game. But even tracking that, you'll be able to understand how much alcohol you're drinking on the female side. They get together, the women get together, and they drink wine. You know, so it's comparable on each side, but it's something that relates to everyone when you're in a social atmosphere, right? We talk about alcohol consumption. We talk about eating out. How often are we eating out? How often are we cooking for ourselves? How often are we consuming water versus non-water products, including coffee? So definitely start with the assessment first. I think that's the baby step and acknowledgement of where you are. The other part of that is, and then of course you start to make the transition. Okay, let me remove, you know, instead of having 3 cups of coffee a day, let me just tear it down to 2 for the next 2 weeks. Or even eating out. Okay, maybe I can only eat out on, you know, Twisted Tuesdays, or, you know, your favorite place that has, you know, some type of favorite food that you have, or a discount, you know, buy 2, get 1 or whatever. So start to condense those type of habits. The other part of that is the exercise. So usually what I find is people are so excited to make that change, especially during resolution season. They're like, I'm cutting everything out, I'm done. And then it's kind of like starvation mode for your body. And then you start craving things. And then, you know, and you work out in the gym, you're like, I'm going to work out 6 times a week. When someone, you know, coming from a sedentary lifestyle, they haven't worked out at all. So they go from 0 to 100 without considering the fact that you're shocking your body. And that's not always a healthy response to it, right? If you're fasting, that's something different, whether it's religious reasons or personal reasons. The fasting aspect is different. When you're talking about making such a drastic lifestyle change, you're right. It's important to do those baby steps and say, you know what? I'm going to walk 30 minutes per day, 3 days a week. That's perfect. As you start to become more comfortable with that, then you can say, and you assess your body too. Am I having aches? Are my knees hurting? Are my ankles hurting? Is my back hurting from exercising? Then you can change the type of exercise that works best for you. Maybe you need to start in a pool rather than start walking, because there's less pressure on your joints being in the pool versus walking on a treadmill or on a trail. So it all comes back to not only taking the baby steps, but also going through that assessment process to really be honest with yourself and say, hey, I do want to make these big changes in the future, but what can I be doing right now in the short term to make sure that it's consistent in those baby steps to make a huge impact in weight management and or eating healthy. Did that make sense?
Yeah, it does make sense. It does make sense. We might have to hold this over. You got 2 more to go, don't you?
I do have 2 more to go.
Yeah, we're going to have to hold that over for next week for a part 2. Ooh, of self-care, because John's question was just so good, and how you broke down the ladies drinking the wine, probably the Sutter Home or the Moscato or the, you know, other Vernettes.
All
of that good stuff.
Because
I was saying last segment, I'm on that Bombay Sapphire.
Okay.
I'm hitting hard magic blue.
Okay.
The magic blue. Cranberry juice. Or the cream grape juice. Or the OJ. You call it, it's the Bombay Sapphire.
Okay.
Magic blue, people. So, yes, indeed. So we're going to save 3 and 4 for next week.
Yes.
Self-care, because Lord know, Dr. V got some good stuff for you.
Yes. Yes, I do. I look forward to part 2.
Yes, indeed, folks. Dr. Vernette, Health and Wellness segment. We're going to come back next week. We out.
All your photo, video, and voiceover needs, check out the fine folks at Blu-ray Productions. They will take good care of you. If you don't believe me, you can see for yourself. Check out their work at blueberryproductions.tv, the Facebook page, Blueberry Productions, also a Vimeo page, a YouTube page, and it's Blueberry, B-L-U-B-E-R-R-Y, prod on Twitter. Check them out today. Blueberry Productions, great people, great work, great service.
To get healthy here on the Boss Man Show, about to be joined by health wellness expert Dr. Vernette to speak some more about part 2 of the importance of self-care. She's going to break it down for you as only she can, because she's able to the wellness. I'm expert in unhealthy and unwell around here before I say that segment. So let's turn off Dr. Vernette to get us healthy and off of the what I talked about that segment.
There, you're so funny. So today I want to dive right into where we left off with just a brief review of what we talked about in part 1. So in part 1, the overall series is, the two-part series is taking good care of yourself. And I'm going to share with the audience 4 ways that we can tap into taking good care of ourselves. So the first 2 that we dived in while we were discussing the part 1 segment was, first, working towards your goals, and the second one, caring for yourself. Today's segment, we're going to talk about the last 2, which is building strong passions and meditation, which is probably one of my favorite. And we'll talk about why it's my favorite when we get there. So let's go ahead and talk about building strong connections or strengthening your connections. It's important to incorporate joy and spirit and relaxation into your life, build a healthy lifestyle. And so I'd like to give 4 C's as in cat, to creating that joy, joy and relaxation, right? So we're looking at the first C, connect with yourself, connect with others, connect to your community, and create joy and satisfaction. The first C. The first C talks about connecting with yourself and what that looks like. And really, it's super simple, right? And checking with yourself periodically. We've talked on different segments about doing a body scan and what that looks like, or being present with your inner self and what that, right? So a lot of times, we don't really realize that things are changing, things are evolving, or going through transitions, and just really be present with whatever that looks like. Most times it comes as in a stressor, right? We talk about maintaining stress in another segment. But if we're able to get a different perspective and say, you know, hey, what is going on? Different, like, what's the same? Acknowledging that that is it, but not bringing judgment to it, okay? So in ways to do that, you can journal about your experiences. I remember talking about that in another segment. Keeping a journal.
The right.
Mm-hmm. What
you have to write. Because as you said, most women like to write stuff down.
Top
of my head.
We talked about that. So when you like to write down, and that's fine. We also talked about what the when you get together, I think women were drinking wine and the guys drink beer. I don't use that phone number. But
yes.
Keeping a journal is really a great way to learn about yourself. So whether it's a digital journal or it's a traditional pen and paper, which actually I have slight nerd moment. Wingers and paper, you're accessing your tactile skills. So those are the skills that originate in front in your brain that's responsible for executive function, decision making, and higher thinking, right? So we're also integrating of our the lobes of the brain in order to continue to be progressive and maintain the integrity of our brain tissue. Okay, so that was kind of a little nerd moment. But when you're integrating writing versus typing, look at penmanship, and penmanship can change whether it's cursive or it's print, it's all caps or whether it's low caps. Like, you can get super deep into it, but that was kind of a nerd moment. But if you're able to keep a journal, whether it's digital on your phone, make a couple notes, that allows you to kind of track where you are and the piece that you're in at the present time. Another way is to, when you're connecting to yourself, is to come at it and share your story, right? So for me personally, I've got a couple of different stories and a couple of different advocacies that I am involved in. One of them, as we talked in another segment of surrogacy, so I'm a gestational surrogate for another family that's unable to create their family. And for me, that is healing, especially with the history that I come from. So if you're interested in that, then, you know, tap back into our first segment that we did together about what my journey was. And that's also helped for me to be able to connect with myself, understand, to manage myself a lot better, because there's a lot of things that go on a daily basis that I'm not in control of. And that's where the stress comes in, right? You want to manage it, just suppress it, or not even deal with it. So the second C,
exactly.
The second C is connect with others. So building a lot of people that are going to be a support system for you and vice versa, you for them. And when we're around people that help improve our mood and improve how we feel and connect with one another on a more intimate level, we're really becoming more balanced. Also, just socialization, networking, finding out different things that you like, that you don't like, and doing it with a group of people can also allow you to have increased happiness, better health, and really overall a longer life. Okay. Now, the third. Yes.
You believe this? She's antisocial. You wouldn't believe that, though.
You're antisocial?
Yeah.
Like the whole radio station. Like, you're both.
Outside of the radio world.
Uh-huh.
It was just in my personal life, when I back into the main, per se.
Yes.
I'm antisocial.
Is it antisocial, or is it more of an introvert personality where you would prefer to be within your own safe space versus, you know, and gather your own energy, your own balance within your own self, right? Or, you know, you just kind of don't want to deal with other people.
John, I tell you, I'm usually around a guy named JC a lot, and when we're outside of the radio, we want to be out. So it's kind of like, I don't like your face. But so with the radio world, I'm cool and congenial, jovial, blah, blah, blah. But once I just feel like I'll be Jermaine, you guys will have to be in Jonathan. We don't want to be bothered.
Okay. You know? Well, I receive that, like, right? Okay.
And so it's like one of them things where, you know, you play a role. But it's like, you know what your job is. When you turn off your job, you become who you really are. So for me, when I'm outside of the radio, I talk fast. I don't tell them because I'm Dominican by default, and I don't want to deal with people.
Yeah.
Now, so until we're together, we don't have to be bothered. We just do our thing.
So, John, how do you feel? Like, are you introverted or more extroverted?
I'm extroverted, but I would say I'm good, and I will start a conversation with random people, like at the store or whatever, if I'm waiting in line. I'm the type of person that'll just say something to just, you know, BS back and forth. But in my downtime, like when I come home from work, I'm just with my family or have a little bit of alone time by myself. Or maybe I'll sit out back and get a cold, you know, glass of water, tea or something. Just maybe flip through my phone. But really just I like to have some period of time in my life where I'm just quiet time for me. But as a, you know, overarching theme in my life, I am extroverted.
Now, I love diversity because, you know, we come into this type of platform and, you know, we have conversations with different guests on the show or even the dialogue between the three. It's interesting to see different people's backgrounds and what it looks like to kind of be off, unplugged, if you will, and see what that true personality is. And honestly, like, there's no good, bad, or really indifferent. It's just how do we regain our energy? How do we regain our space back, our comfortability? And so I love the dialogue between, you know, JR's off mode and John, your off mode. And even though I think I am introverted, I do like to exchange different energies with people. And that's just what I do in the that I work in. But I also do appreciate that alone time where I am off. You know, I turn off my phone. It's either on do not disturb or it's just on airplane mode where I take space, reserve some time for myself. And it could be as simple as just being outside, drinking a glass of water, or it could be me taking a yoga class or reading a book, right? So those are the things that kind of regenerate my energy, even though I'm like, which is interesting. So I love the fact that we were able to share that. But as we continue, I want to jump into the fourth one, the fourth one, create joy and satisfaction. And really, that's kind of self-explanatory. Studies will show that napping reduces pain and reduces anxiety. It helps your heart and your lungs and promotes muscle relaxation. Even having positive emotions can decrease stress hormones and build emotional strength. And even leisure activities allow you to healthy distractions from some stressful. And so different tips that I can offer really, maybe do something that you love to do as a kid, right? Running through the sprinklers or climbing bars. Do something that you've always wanted to do, or listen or watch a comedy show or podcast that you feel like a massage. I mean, that's like a go-to, right? And then the last one, which is of course my favorite because of the field that I'm in, is just take a trip. You know, a blue sky or a scenic lake or a route, you know, that you may take on a trail or even, you know, any mountain. The last suggestion that I have, last tip of taking good care of yourself is the meditation, right? And I'll stick with this one. Meditation is really simple. It's really simple. A lot of people think that you've got to be in tune with your body. You've got to have this mantra. You've got to be a yogi. And, you know, you have to have all these things. And it's really simple as being still. So the different types of meditation that our audience can kind of dive into at a later time is you can meditate deep breathing, right? You're sitting or lying comfortably. You're resting your hands on your stomach and slowly count to four while inhaling through the nose, feeling your stomach rise. You then hold your breath for a second and slowly count to four while you exhale, verbally, through kind of your lips being a little pursed. And then just allow your stomach to fall slowly and repeat that time. You've also got mindful meditation, which is where you're being mindful of your breath work. So you're focusing on your breath. So it's easy to pass through the awareness without judgment. And we just talked about that. Not having judgment, but just having awareness with your body. And if your mind starts to wander or try to tap to do, to return back to that focused breath, right? So that's mindful meditation. You've got visualization. Visualization will open your eyes. Relax and just imagine a peaceful place, whatever that looks like for you. And engage all of your senses. What do you smell? What do you hear? What do you feel? And then going from there. So that's visualization. Repeating a mantra. So we're huge right now in our culture of positive affirmation. What affirmation am I going to live through today? And so that's really just sitting quietly, picking any meaningful word or phrase or even a sound, right? Sound therapy. And just repeating that mantra aloud or silently. That's being able to physically relax. And then the last one is participate in a meditative form of exercise. We talk about yoga, body tai chi. So really those are the type of different meditations that will really get your body centered. So that way you're able to offer calmness to your body and help with anxiety and depression and even some physical things like cancer, chronic pain, asthma, heart disease, and even high blood pressure. So those are four things to wrap up part two. Like I said, in part one, if you'd like to look into the full segment, we talked about working for goals, caring for yourself, and today we talked about building strong connections and meditating. So that's what I have for today.
So, Doctor, I just wanted to touch on the breathing a little bit. There was a period in my life where I was dealing with some anxiety, and I was taught called squared breathing, which sounds like deep breathing technique that you were talking about, where I breathe in for 4 seconds, hold for 4 seconds, exhale for four, hold for four, so on and so forth. Is that something that would be commonly recommended for people who deal with anxiety to calm their mind and help prevent their mind from racing?
Yeah, absolutely. And there's so many different techniques, to be honest with you. From what I know, the limited information of square breathing is you're looking at, like you said, the technique of working. Like you're inhaling for 4 seconds, you hold for 4 seconds, you're exhaling for 4 seconds, and you're repeating that four times. And really breathing, I'm really looking at it without getting too deep into it, because y'all know I'll go on a nerd tangent. But breathing comes from breathing comes from your parasympathetic system, right? So if you're looking at fight or flight, which is your sympathetic system. That's that your brain blinks, right? Because your brain doesn't physically have eyes. It takes in every sensation, right? It takes in what comes in from your eyes, what you're hearing, what you're seeing, what the receptors are giving you, right? And then it interprets it into something that is recognizable, right? So our brain doesn't really have eyes. It just takes in all those senses at once. And so when we're in the sympathetic system, which is in lay term known as fight or flight, you have increased heart rate, your pupils are dilated, blood pressure is higher, all of the circulation is going to your muscles, right? It's not going to be centered into your organs because you're concerned of running away because it's like a bear coming. You're going to fly out of dodge in order not to get eaten by the bear, right? So our body knows no different when you are handling a stressful situation and not being able to really tap into the balance or the homeostasis of integrating parasympathetic, right? Which brings me to the breathing aspect of it. Breathing is so fundamental. A lot of times we don't really know how to breathe. So when I speak about breathing to my patients, I tend to do whatever their typical breath is, right? So it's like, okay, just breathe normally. Like, what does that look like for you? And then we start to talk about breathing through your chest. Are you belly breathing? Are you doing both? Are you doing a circumduction breathing, which means you're breathing anterior, posterior, and laterally? So you're doing a 360 breathing. So like I said, it can get super, super deep. But to keep it really simple, when that works, I find that they're either holding their breath or doing the shallow breathing, which is the chest breathing. So your diaphragm, which is directly, it's a dome-shaped muscle, kind of like a Georgia dome, a dome-shaped muscle that's directly underneath your lungs and for your abdominal organ with your lungs. So if you're not expanding your diaphragm, right, you're losing all your motion, you're losing oxygen and carbon dioxide exchange, right, so your gas is exchange, and you're not really getting the nutrients that you need or to function optimally. Which your brain needs oxygen. It needs three things. It needs oxygen, glucose, which is simple sugar. It needs oxygen in order for it to function properly. Your body needs so much more, but even on a fundamental level, if we're not breathing appropriately, then really we're creating preventable diseases or conditions that end up having these residual effects, right? Kind of a domino effect. So getting back to the technique of deep breathing and regular breathing, when you're looking at the parasympathetic system, which is the rest and digest, right? So you're looking at organ digestive system, and then also resting your muscles, resting your mind, resting your body. When we don't tap into that, we don't have function properly with this homeostasis conversation, right? What I mean by that is it's natural to have your parasympathetic system and your sympathetic system kind of go on this seesaw approach, right? That's homeostasis, finding that balance. So there are going to be situations where exercising, that elevates your heart rate. That's going to dilate your pupils. But then also taking some time for yourself, your body, that like relaxation, breathing techniques, that helps you level that stimulation that you just had from the sympathetic system to also be able to bring it down. So your body is supposed to go through this kind of seesaw approach. A lot of times in our community, what I find is that we don't know how to breathe, which we learn how to do tummy time as a baby. And you start to kind of push up, and you're in this 4.5 and you're rocking back and forth and figuring out what that pelvis looks like. And they start to pull up, right? Then they start to kind of figure out what their pelvis is. So it's almost like a forth, right? If you can find that imagery. And then they start to walk, and the baby's fine. You know, so you're going through these developmental processes or these milestones, which you call in the clinical world. It's the same thing with breathing. You have to be able to teach yourself how to breathe or to have it to be a natural habit. Because we don't sit still and teach ourselves how to breathe, we don't breathe. Either we don't breathe or we don't breathe appropriately. So when you're looking at the technique of the square breathing or deep breathing or any other type of breathing that you've been exposed to, it's really important to understand why you're breathing and the effects and benefits that come from breathing, especially when we're in a society that is stressed. It is going to come. You can't control it. It's just how you maintain it. To make a full circle back to your question, John, absolutely important to be able to access breathing techniques, especially in stressful situations, in order to not only manage stress, but to reduce the opportunities to encounter preventative diseases or conditions.
Nice.
Y'all still there?
Makes sense to me. I was just like sitting here taking some notes on what you're saying. I was making my little notes over here. Yeah, it makes perfect sense to me. I never thought about it from that perspective before. Obviously, I was on the other side of it getting the advice, so now I know why the advice is given, and it makes a lot of sense to me. Thank you.
Yeah, no problem.